Good morning, everybody. Welcome back to Foundations in Faith. I say good morning because it's morning when I'm recording this, but welcome to you whenever, wherever you are watching this video. If you weren't able to tune into the last video, you can go back and take a quick look at that if you'd like, but just in short, what we're looking to do is really give kind of the basis, the foundations of our Christian and our Lutheran faith over and against maybe different denominations, Catholicism, or different things like that. Really explain in short what it means to be not only Christian, but what it means to be Lutheran. And we're going to be doing that by walking through the Augsburg Confession, the Apology of the Augsburg Confession, as well as Luther's large and small catechisms, bringing alongside Scripture as the foundation, as the basis for all of these documents and everything we're going to have moving forward. So let's dive right in this morning. As we dive in, the first article in the Augsburg Confession, that's going to be our controlling document, the one that we journey through for looking at our different topics. And so the first article deals with God. Who is God? What does he do? What's kind of the character of God? What characteristics are we looking at when we talk about God? And as we look at the Augsburg Confession, this actually is one of the shortcomings of journeying through the Augsburg Confession, because the debate over God, there really wasn't too much of a debate at that time that it was written. Most of this debate over God was actually settled at the Council of Nicaea in 325 AD. And that was when we were dealing with kind of Arianism, the different heresies revolving around Jesus in particular. We'll get there. We'll get there in the coming weeks as we do talk about Jesus. But the point of that is to say that Romans, who Luther was writing against in Roman Catholicism, and Lutherans really do agree on their doctrine of who God is. Now, what that looks like and how that plays out, yeah, okay, we have some differences, but in general, and in the Augsburg Confession, they really didn't have much to talk about. And so in the Augsburg Confession and the Apology to the Augsburg Confession, this article is very, very short, basically says, we agree with the Roman Catholics on this doctrine of God. So we're going to be journeying through today mostly the Catechism, and we're going to be walking through the Apostles' Creed as well as we look at God. But before we dive into that, I do have to have a short excursus right off the bat to say that the Augsburg Confession and the Catechism don't really directly address the doctrine of the Trinity. Now, if you've been around Christianity for any amount of time, you've probably heard of the doctrine of the Trinity, and it's very confusing to you. That's okay. It's very confusing to us as well as professional theologians, to anyone that thinks and writes about the Trinity, mostly because we just don't understand the inner workings of God and the Godhead and the Trinity. That's not given to us to understand. God doesn't outline that in Scripture and say, this is exactly what it looks like, so this is what you need to know. But that being said, we can draw some conclusions from Scripture. We can say with certainty at least a few areas of what the Trinity looks like. So we can say that there is one God. There is only one God. We uphold that from the very beginning, the foundations of Christianity. We uphold that still now, 2,000 years later, after Jesus. We uphold that from the very beginning of time, really. There is one God. But within that one God, there are three persons to that Godhead. I know this sounds confusing. That's okay. We don't have to have a full understanding of it. That's the beauty of faith, is that God speaks it. God says it's true. We believe that. And hopefully when we get to heaven, we'll be able to have those discussions with him and figure out what that really looks like. But for now, for our purposes, it's good enough to say there is one God. There are three persons. So those three persons are God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Now, there are different metaphors to try and help us understand maybe a little bit of what this looks like. You've probably heard some of them. You've probably heard God is kind of like an apple. So there's the skin of the apple, there's kind of the flesh, the meat of the apple, and then there's the core and the seeds of the apple. Three distinct parts of the apple, and yet they're all apple. Maybe you've heard of the water metaphor, how water is chemically the same, and yet it can be organized into different ways, saying that it's ice, saying that it's liquid water, saying that it's steam. These are helpful metaphors in the way that they help us think about God, but all metaphors break down if you push them far enough. And that's the same thing that is true with these metaphors. We really cannot capture with created things everything that it means for God to be one, but still three distinct persons. So again, it's something we have to take on faith. It's something we have to believe because God speaks this about himself. Scripture speaks this and speaks in this way. And hopefully we'll be able to learn more once we get into heaven. So we'll cover a little bit of the doctrine of the Trinity. We'll touch on it in each place that we touch on the three persons. But today, this morning, we're going to be walking through the first person of the Trinity, God the Father. What does Scripture have to say about that? What does the Apostles' Creed have to say about that? And so, as I said, we are going to be walking through the Apostles' Creed. The first article really deals with God the Father. So if you didn't know this, the Apostles' Creed is divided into three articles, and each article deals with a different person in the Trinity. So the first article deals with God, the second article deals with Jesus, the third article deals with the Holy Spirit. So the first article of the Apostles' Creed says, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. And for Luther, as he based his catechism, large and small, off of the Apostles' Creed, this was enough for a basic understanding, for a foundation of God in informing the Christian faith and informing the average Christian. And the first point that he makes is God is creator. God is the maker of heaven and earth. So I have a quick exercise for you. I'd like you to take part in this. If you have a moment, pause this video really quickly. Go grab a piece of paper and a pen. I'm going to give you a few words to write down and divide. If you don't have paper and pen, if you don't want to take time and do that, just kind of visualize this in my head, in your head, as we walk through this exercise. So I hope you grabbed that paper, and if you didn't, that's all right. Just be able to follow along and kind of think about these things. I'm going to give you a few words. What I want you to do as you sit there, as you think about it, maybe as you write it down, is divide these words into two separate categories. So if you were going to place words together in different categories, which words would you separate out? Hopefully that makes sense. We'll journey forward, and hopefully it'll become clear if it doesn't make sense yet. So the words that I have for you, as I have them written down, I need to find them. Write down God, angels, animals, plants, man, demon, and earth. So one more time, those words are God, angels, animal, plants, man, demon, and earth. Now take those seven words, divide them into two categories. How would you classify these different words? And just be as free with it as you want. There's no right or wrong answer. I'm going to illustrate a point, and it's not something to get too worried about. But I would venture a guess that most of you, as you write these words down, you place them in categories of God, angels, and demons on one side, and you place all the other ones, earth, animals, plants, and man, on another side. Kind of separated them out in that way. And this makes sense to our human way of thinking. This is kind of saying that we have the physical, the material, earth, animals, plants, kind of the things that we see are here in one category, and then kind of the spiritual, the metaphysical, the stuff that's out there that we can't really see, of God, angels, demons, those are in another category. And I had this exercise shown to me in seminary. It's a wonderful exercise to illustrate that this is not the way we should be dividing these words. If we were to do it scripturally, we would have God in one category, all on his own, and all those other words would be another category. And the point of that illustration is to say that everything we know besides God is created. God is the only uncreated being. He was there before time. He was there before creation, before any of the substance, the stuff that's around us came into being. And that God actually created all of these things. So angels and demons are creations of God. Yes, affected by the fall, we'll get there. But these are creations. Earth, land, animals, plants, you and me, we are creations of God. And so part of the Christian life, part of what it means to be Christian, part of what it means to be Lutheran, is living in that reality. That we are not God, that we are not the God of our own lives as well, but that we are creatures. We have been designed and created with a purpose, that purpose being to serve God the Father Almighty. So as we get into creation, this is what Scripture starts out with in the Old Testament, the story of creation. Many of you have probably heard Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. What that looks like exactly, we're not 100% sure, but we do know a few things from Genesis that God spoke into creation. So as we talk about the Trinity, we see already in Genesis, in the first chapter of the Bible, the Trinity is present. Although a little bit veiled, we see God the Father, we see God the Son, who is the Word of God as God speaks, and then Genesis speaks about the Spirit of God, we would say the Holy Spirit, hovering over the waters, hovering over the uncreated void is maybe another way to say that. So the Trinity is present within the very first chapter of Scripture. I do want to make that point. But God creates by speaking. God creates through Jesus by speaking. And the biblical narrative is actually pretty clear on this takes 6 days. So we get into different theories of creation, different theories of the beginning. What does it look like for the beginning of the world, the beginning of man? You've heard different theories as well. One of the most common, the popular theories of creation is actually evolution. That in the beginning was nothing. There was a big bang where a whole bunch of something came from nothing, which makes a whole lot of sense. And then that whole bunch of something was very disorganized, it was scattered, it was random, and over millions and billions of years of random chance, everything came together to form the world that we know. And Scripture speaks strongly against that narrative. We would say, and we have to say from Scripture, that no, rather than random chance in a big bang millions and billions of years ago, there is a creator, there is intelligent design, there is an intelligent being behind the workings of the universe and the creation of the universe. So there have been attempts to kind of actually join these two in what we would call theistic evolution. And this is the theory that God basically wound up the universe like a giant clock. He set everything into motion for evolution to take place in the way that they say it did. Then he kind of stepped back and he said, all right, nature, take your course. When we look at that, a lot of people like this because it does join what modern science says in evolution alongside the religious element of creation. But again, as we read through the opening chapters of Genesis, we have to say, no, creation took place over 6 days. God made it happen very, very quickly. God ordered it in a certain way very, very quickly and created in that way. So another way kind of around this to maybe try and join together creation alongside evolution or science is something called the day-age theory. And this says that in Genesis, those portions that speak of God creating over a day, that's just poetic language. And a day really means kind of an age or eons or a very extended amount of time. So God created the heavens and the earth. He created the sun and the stars and all the lights. But that took place over millions of years through the process of evolution. So this basically is the same thing of kind of theistic evolution, of God being the clockmaker that winds everything up and lets it happen. But again, trying to join together creation and evolution. And to all of that, as Lutherans, we would say, no, Scripture is very, very clear. It takes place over 6 days. And we say this because, one, we let Scripture interpret Scripture. And in that I mean that whenever day is used outside of poetic language, whenever that term is used outside of poetic language, like within the Psalms, it means a 24-hour period. Alongside that, Genesis is very clear. There was evening, there was morning, the first day. So we take that and we say, okay, we have evening and morning. It's morning right now. Evening's going to come. Tomorrow morning, 24 hours later, it will be the same time. That's one day. That hasn't changed. That hasn't changed from the beginning of creation to now. So God actually means one day when he says one day in Genesis. So all of that to say, Genesis and the foundation of our faith is that God created the heavens and the earth in 6 days. He took 6 days to create everything we see outside this beautiful window right here, everything that we know, everything that we interact with, everything that we don't know that's out there in the great expanse of the universe. God created over 6 days. On the seventh day, then, he rested. And as we look at that, this is how we get the rhythm for our weeks as well. We live, we operate with a seven-day week. That's how our calendar works. That's how the seasons work, broken into seven-day weeks. That's how the years work, broken into 52 seven-day cycles. And so we see God has ordered it in this way, really modeled after how he created the heavens and the earth. So again, we let Scripture interpret Scripture in that way. This is how God is created. This is how God speaks of it. This is how Jesus speaks of it. This is how we order our lives. Why are we trying to denounce that power of God? Why are we trying to say, no, he had to operate over millions of years, or that's how it did happen? When Scripture very clearly says, 6 days, evening and morning, God created. On the seventh day, he rested. So that's kind of the basic understanding. It's a lot more nuanced. There's a lot more discussion and argument that happens even within Lutheran circles about what this looks like as we get into original languages, as we get into different portions of bringing in the Psalms, bringing in that kind of thing. But just for a basic understanding, this is what we would believe as Christians and as Lutherans. God created in 6 days. On the seventh day, he rested. And God created everything that we see around us. But as we get into that as well, God the Father is not just a creator. There's so much more to him, so much more to his character. And Luther dives into this extremely, extremely deeply within the catechisms. As I've already said, there really wasn't much debate over God creating at that time. Most people accepted that God created the heavens and the earth. Whether that happened over a long period or a short period, again, wasn't too much of a debate at the time of Luther. What he really dives into, though, is kind of a second characteristic of God, and saying that not only does he create, but he sustains as well. And by that I mean God gives us everything that we need to sustain life. God is still present and active in the world, sustaining everything that we see around us. Another way to say that would be is if God were to remove himself from the world, if God were to remove himself from creation, creation would cease to exist. God is an active force in our world right now at this present moment, creating, sustaining, giving everything that we need for life to continue. So I have Luther's large catechism here. I'm going to read a portion of that just to show and articulate what Luther had to say about that. And as he says, what does it mean for us to believe that God is a sustainer? The answer he has is, I hold and believe that I am God's creature. That is, he's given me and constantly sustains my body and soul, my life, my members, great and small, all my senses, my reason and understanding and the like, my food, my drink, clothing, nourishment, spouse and children, servants, house, farm, all of those things and more. Besides, he makes all creation help to provide the benefits and necessities of life. The sun, the moon, the stars in the heavens, day and night, air, fire, water, the earth, all that it yields and brings forth. Not only that, the birds, the fish, the animals, grain, all sorts of produce. Moreover, he gives all physical and temporal blessings, good government, peace, security. Thus we learn from this article in the Creed, God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, that none of us has life. None of us has life or anything else that has been mentioned here or even can be mentioned from ourselves. Nor can we by ourselves preserve any of them, however small and unimportant. All of this is comprehended in the word creator. So it's a little bit long-winded. Luther sometimes gets a little bit verbose. So all that to say, God creates everything that we see around us, but God sustains those things as well. He's constantly providing rain. He's constantly providing nourishment to the soil and to the plants. So those plants can be grown up, so those plants can nourish us and our bodies and our thoughts and our understanding and help us to live and to thrive. But so much more than just the natural things, God also gives government. God gives peace. God gives security. He dives into that a little bit more, as he says a little bit later. He daily guards and defends us against every evil and misfortune, warding off all kinds of danger and disasters. So again, saying that God is present and active in this world, it's not that he stepped back and he's kind of letting us do our own thing. No, God is here. He's working for us. He's working in our lives in ways that we can't even see, we can't even understand. So one exercise, one thing that you can kind of start taking note of as you go about your day, those little inconveniences, those little things that you kind of shrug your head at, and, oh man, I wish that didn't happen. Getting stopped at a red light, dropping your keys, forgetting your keys, having to go back to the house and get them. Sometimes, I would posit, and I don't have proof of this besides what Luther writes here and besides knowing that God is providing and protecting us, but sometimes I think those are actually protections from God. And saying you got stopped at that red light, what you didn't know is that if you had gone through it, there's a car coming 2 minutes down the road that would have T-boned you. As you drop your keys, what you don't know is that that short 15-second delay to bend down and pick up your keys means you hit that red light so that you didn't get in that accident. As you have to turn around and go back and get your phone or your wallet from your house, that means you missed an accident that may have happened on your way to work. Just a few examples that we can't know, we don't know, but that's kind of the point. We don't know, we can't understand how much God is actively protecting us against as we go about our daily lives. Luther reminds us within the Catechism to be cognizant of that. that we don't know that, and to give thanks for God, give thanks to God for all the ways that He is active in our lives. So all of this comes together for Luther, and he says, okay, but what does this matter for our lives? What does it matter that God is creator and sustainer of everything that we see, that we know around us, that He does protect us? He goes on to say on that regard and on that topic, if we believed this doctrine, if we believed that God created everything, that God sustains everything, that God protects us in this way, if we believed it with our whole heart, we would also act accordingly. What does that look like? We wouldn't swagger about and boast and brag as if we had life, riches, power, honor, and such things of ourselves, as if we ourselves were to be feared and served. You see, for Luther, for us as Lutherans, the ultimate, the number one, is always to give glory to God, to keep God in His rightful place as number one within our lives. And as we get into the Ten Commandments, this is kind of Luther's big thing. The first commandment informs everything else in the Christian life. The first commandment, you shall have no other gods before me, before Yahweh, before God the Creator. And so if we fail to acknowledge that He is creator, that He is sustainer, if we believe that some of these things are from us because of our own power, our own honor, we actually place ourselves over God in our lives. We become our own God in our lives. And so Luther is quick to say, no, no, no. You have to remember, you're nothing but a creature. God has given you all of these things. God has given you wealth or power or honor or a good reputation or whatever it may be. You need to use those things to honor and glorify Him. And that's the quick overview of what Luther believes, what Luther teaches on God the Father. So we've covered God Almighty. We've covered Maker of Heaven and Earth. As we look at that term Almighty, we get into a little bit of the characteristics of God. What are kind of the things that make God who He is? And as we get into that, we see that God is a Father. God is someone who invites us into a relationship. God is someone who protects, who provides, who gives us everything we need. And that's where we get the term Father, not only from the characteristics that He exemplifies there, but also from Jesus, from His own words. As the disciples came to Him and said, how should we pray? Jesus says, pray in this way, our Father, our God, our Father in heaven, holy is your name, hallowed be your name. And this really captures and encapsulates everything that we've been talking about this morning. God is our Father. He provides, He gives all these things that a good father should give us. James 1:17 speaks in this way as well. It says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, coming down from God who creates, who sustains us. Not only is He creator, sustainer, provider in that way, and that's why we call Him Father, we also call Him Father because He wants that relationship with us. He invites us into relationship through Jesus. He invites us into His family. He calls us His sons. He calls us His daughters because of Jesus and because of Jesus' work on the cross. So I know I said we're focusing on God the Father, the first person of the Trinity, but you'll find very quickly within Christianity and within Lutheran circles, you can't really talk about anything without talking about Jesus, because everything comes back to Jesus. Everything comes back to His work on the cross. Everything comes back to how the cross and the empty grave have changed us, have changed how we view life. And this is very short called a theology of the cross, that we see everything through the narrative, through the lens of what happened on the cross. God the Father is no exception to that. We view God, we view our relationship, we view everything that we know about God through the cross, in saying that God loves us so much that He was willing to die for us on the cross, that He was willing to do that to forgive our sins, to invite us into relationship with Him so that we could live with Him in heaven for eternity. So again, we'll touch on some of those things as we get into Jesus, as we get into justification in just a few short weeks here. But for now, our focus is that God invites us into a relationship. He wants to be that Father to us as we are His dear and loved children. The last word that I want to look at is Almighty, within the first article of the Apostles' Creed there. What does it mean that God is Almighty? And this speaks to some of the characteristics maybe you've heard to describe God. God is omnipotent, God is omniscient, God is immutable, all these other words that describe God. God is all-powerful, God is all-knowing, God is unchanging, God is constant, God is eternal, all of these things. We could dive into all of those words. We could look at all of those words in pretty great detail. I think that's a little bit outside the scope of what we're trying to do here. I want to take all those words and just say that God is all-powerful. God is in control. There's nothing greater than God in the entire universe. God is the one that everything begins and ends with. So God is all in control over and against the powers and the forces of evil, over and against Satan, over and against the things that would affect us in this life. God is almighty. God is in control. God is all powerful. This is a beautiful word of hope and comfort for us. As we look at the world around us, we're in the middle of the coronavirus. Yes, we might say, okay, that's powerful. That's disrupting our lives. That's disrupting the economy. That's caused death. That's caused illness and sickness and hardship and suffering for so many people. But even in the midst of that, God is in control. God is more powerful than the coronavirus. God is more powerful than this sickness going around. God is more powerful than the United States economy. God is able to work within these situations, to work even within the coronavirus, turn that around for His glory. And just one brief example of the way that this is already happening is that it's forced a lot of churches to actually go online, to go digital. We've done that here at St. Paul as we've started live streaming services, as we've started bringing these studies to you and the ability to access them online. The Word of God is going out in a way that it's never gone out before, in a volume, in a magnitude that it's never gone out before. And people are putting out materials just like this. People are worshiping God all around the globe in the midst of this virus. So God has not sent the virus. No, that's a result of the fall. That's a result of sin, that we have sickness and death and things like that in the world. But I can say that God is using this for His glory. God is using this to draw people to Himself. God is using this to show Himself to the world, to put that word out there, much in the same way that you're listening to this right now. So God is almighty. God is all-powerful. God is able to use all of these things, all of His creation, to bring Himself glory so that more and more people could hear about Him, so that more and more people would have faith in Him. So that is a really quick overview of God the Father, the first person of the Trinity. As I said last week, if you have questions, if you have interactions, I do invite you either to email me, PastorAndrew@stpaulboca.com, PastorAndrew@stpaulboca.com. I would love to be in conversation with you over email, over phone, over text, whatever that looks like. You can also leave a comment just down below here on this YouTube video, be able to interact in that way as well. Next week, we're going to continue walking through the Augsburg Confession. That's where things get a little bit more exciting as we dive into original sin. So just a quick narrative, the Augsburg Confession kind of follows the narrative of Scripture. So it makes sense the way that it's laid out, and that we have God the Father, we have God creating over 7 days everything that we see in a perfect fashion. There was no sin in that creation. But as creation moves forward, as mankind comes onto the picture, the next thing that happens is sin, is the fall. So the Augsburg Confession takes that next step and says, okay, what is original sin? What is sin? What happened in the fall? All of that. So we'll be diving into that next week. For this week, for the remainder of the week, as y'all are learning and studying and growing in what it means to be creatures of God, I pray His blessings on you. I pray His protection on you. I pray He keeps you cognizant that He is there. He is sustaining your life, that He loves you, that He cares for you. Jesus loves you. Have a wonderful day. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next time.